Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Resonant Arcade.
Arcade!
How are y'all doing?
I'm awesome. Good, y'all.
I am Mint.
Mint.
Look!
And
Sam!
We can see
he's
Sam.
He's also got a face this week.
He does.
He's not.
Yep, I decided to put it on. I put it on especially.
Good
for
stuff.
This week.
Yes, Sam is in a different location, so hopefully his internet's going to behave today. Hopefully mine is, because we just had some problems with drop frames on Twitch, but I think it might just have been Twitch, I'll be honest with you. But we're here now, and we're ready to go. So this week we're talking about gaming hardware, peripherals, consoles, upgrading your PC, everything that comes with being a gamer. All of the...
We're not going to talk about upgrading your PC, surely.
Well, that's
you have to
hardware.
Tips, like...
Okay, that's fine.
Why don't,
yeah,
we,
that's
why
fine
don't
enough.
We start with that, in fact?
Okay,
you know?
Then. Yeah, okay.
Because it's, you know, it's not something that everybody
then, Sam,
has to do
start.
As a gamer.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'll see you guys in about 20 minutes.
I've actually just recently done an upgrade to my PC for performance issues rather than, gaming things. I had some issues that I've had to rearrange some things, change boxes, etc. But normally as a gamer... On a PC, anyway, you have to try and keep up to date, at least with graphics cards, CPU, latest CPUs and what they're capable of and things like that. And, you know, I would say categorically everybody who is a PC gamer in any respect has to maintain the PC. They can't just, I don't know, maybe some people just buy a PC every now and again, like from the shop, from the shelf.
I don't think I've ever bought a PC off the shelf, not since 1997 or something, actually.
I bought laptops off the shelf, but not,
it's
PCs.
Kind of difficult to build your own laptop, isn't it?
I believe it can be done, but yeah, it's not something I think I would enjoy doing. But yeah, I think that's a big difference between, this is where we can come into the elite PC gamers versus the versus the scummy
consoles. Console peasants.
Because... That's one of the things we have to work for our gaming. We have to build a PC, actually put it together with our bare hands, and deal with all of the shorting issues you get when you put a new motherboard in a new case that's got some new funky design that is trendy right now, but doesn't quite work for your rig.
And things don't fit in your case, and you end up with a case that's bent outwards like that because you're trying to fit a heatsink this long in it.
That's one of the things I have to
your
do.
Case.
That is just my case, yeah.
I moved my case from a desktop, like a gaming, you know, like with holes in the side, and you know that one you guys would have seen. I think it was a Zigmatech one. I moved it into a rack-mounted case because I wanted to be able to rack mount that a lot of audio stuff with it. So I've now got this PC that's about this long, and it's got loads of room inside, but it's got only got about that much height. So I had to change the CPU heatsink. From a big monster like Venom thing to a low profile silent one, so it's dead quiet, but I'm worried about it overheating now.
There's an interesting false economy that goes on, because I think as a PC gamer I'm quite glad that I only have to pay 25 quid for a game as opposed to 50 quid for a game, but on the other hand, to buy a PC gaming rig you need to spend at least about 700 quid.
Yeah.
And probably more closer to a grand for a decent rig. And you've got to buy it probably with the same sort of frequencies. You'd have to buy a new console. So I think the last time I upgraded my PC and then the upgrade before that is around the same sort of time difference between the Xbox 360 and Xbox One.
But this is probably to do with Moore's Law, though, isn't it? I would imagine. Because,
yeah.
I mean, even console, you know, we don't get the best of the best for a good while before, you know, there are CPUs and GPUs available that we can't get as consumers for a good while, but they release them according to Moore's Law. They keep saying that it's not, it's to do with the fact that they can't advance technology further, but they keep all that stuff to themselves, I think.
Yeah, they're the ubiquitous there. I mean, the most recent graphics cards, they're not really about performance. They're actually about thermal efficiency. So they're about staying cool, basically. Because you've got these things which are pulling, like, you know, hundreds of watts, getting really hot, and then it's like it's getting too hot to do. You can make them faster and faster, but you need stupendous amounts of cooling for them.
Yeah.
So these Maxwell chips, the new NVIDIA stuff, is all just about keeping it cool. So it's interesting that Moore's law is running into the thermal barrier.
Yeah, well, they've always had that issue, though, haven't they? And that's where they're coming into... with CPUs, they're trying to make all of the transistors... Well, all of the transistions, all billions of them. They try and make them smaller and smaller and smaller, and that's what they work towards.
Yeah. You
know, it's part of Moore's law that things are going to get smaller in order for us to advance in technology with the same amount of space being used, if that makes sense. Total sense, in fact. Almost the same amount of space, because they're never exactly right. Otherwise, we'd be able to plug them into the same bloody boards and... things like that.
So there's trade-offs here. When you buy a console, you're basically buying a black box which plays games,
mm-hmm. until,
and maybe just some other things.
And it's self-contained until they release the slim version, or the Go version, or
recently the version which actually works, yes. as opposed to the one which turns red and explodes.
Yeah, I'm very lucky that one of my Xboxes did, red ring of death or whatever it was. But I think it was within warranty, and the one I got after that's been great, and I've played on it loads. So
I can't think of anyone who's owned an Xbox, like a proper Xbox owner who's used it, who hasn't had that. Even mine did it, and I barely played on it. But I give it away to my cousin, and then it red ringed in a couple of months.
Mm.
It's like that's such a huge catastrophic PR disaster that somehow is completely washed off Microsoft. It's like,
that's a good point. No one talks about that anymore, do they, really?
No.
Not that I'm aware of, anyway.
Well, the PlayStation 3 suffered with some acute hardware problems as well.
Well, so did the original PlayStation.
Not as severe.
The original PlayStation with its plastic rails, which caused a laser to go out of alignment, so people had to put it on its side and then upside down, and then eventually buy a new PlayStation. It's like every generation.
I had my PlayStation upside down for a good 3 years.
I think I got someone's hand-me-down PlayStation 1 because I didn't have one myself, and it was already broken, and I had to do something funky with it. I can't remember exactly how I did, but I had to hold something down or put a piece of paper in it to hold it down or something. I can't remember. But I chucked that eventually.
They solved in the end by putting metal rails on it, but basically the laser was on plastic rails and it just used to melt the rails.
But all of the older consoles had little issues like that. You had to, you had the blow the cartridge trick, which you're not supposed to do, but does work a little bit.
Yeah, is the? I mean, that's interesting.
That's not a problem with the console. That's a problem with the way you stored the games.
It is actually, yeah. Or possibly when you're knocking the dust into the thing.
Yeah, but they had dust flaps on them. So unless there was like a heap of dust on there before you put the cartridge in, it'll be all right.
You've got a good point.
Are you not supposed to blow on them then?
Everybody did. It even says
you're supposed to shake Polaroid pictures, but everyone does it.
Yeah.
Sorry, where did it say you were supposed to blow on the cartridges? I never got that memo because
I'm sure it says it on the back of SNES or NES cartridges. Do not
blow. Do not blow.
Do not blow or touch
Yeah, I know you're not meant to touch it. Yeah, you're not meant to touch it because the oil in your finger can corrode the contacts and stuff, can't it?
Yeah, but I've never heard of not blowing on it. You've got the potential of like kind of putting a little bit of spittle on there, and if the spittle acts over two of the contacts, then who knows what happened.
Mm-hmm. Exploding cartridge flies through the ceiling.
We've covered PCs, consoles, elitism already.
Yep.
Cool beat.
5 minutes in.
That PC you said about the games thing, I think that works. Depends on how many games you buy with the price. Because 700 quid for a PC rig or whatever is not that much more when you think about it than a console. The console starting price for each generation is about 400 quid.
Yeah.
That's 300 quid more, but how many games do you get? Like I've got two DVD shelves full of PlayStation 3 games. I think I've got about 40 of them. So over time, that's like a lot of money invested in. And PC games are cheaper. And you've got to take into account all the online stuff like Steam, where you get stuff cheap as chips, like $4.99 Steam sales and stuff. So economically, it probably still works out better on PC. It's just the effort that is required.
Yeah, and it's the technical knowledge as well, and it's the frustration if you're not technically minded. I can understand it. And I mean, really, in realistic terms, the only reason to me, in my eyes, that a PC is better is the control system, is that the fact that you can use so many different peripherals and get it all working. But consoles are catching up with that these days. So it's not that much of a problem these, you know, anymore.
Catching up to you, I wouldn't say catch up. I mean, consoles are certainly innovating within the kind of realm of control.
Mm.
You know, you've got the Kinect now. You've got the six-axis. You've got the Wiimote. You've got quite a few different ways to interact with the console now, which you can do on PC, but it's not natively supported. But is that catching up? Has there been a control method yet better than mouse and keyboard for a first-person shooter? I don't think there has.
Well, again, it's subjective though, isn't it? I mean, I obviously prefer mouse and keyboard because I started as a PC gamer, I think. I didn't, no, actually, I started on consoles. I'm talking right out my bum.
Same here.
But no, I moved to PCs and yes, it works better because you've got more buttons to work with. That was the original reason that I thought it was better. You could, you know, you had more options to and rebind your keys in exactly the right way that you want to
work. Part of it, but the main thing is just the accuracy of control you get from a mouse controlling your aim. I mean, if you put a pad user against a mouse user, the mouse user has got an advantage in speed, in accuracy.
Yeah, 100%. 100%. There's no doubt about
that. And it's crazy that there's been, you know, we're many generations in on the first-person shooter front, and we still haven't topped what is essentially a repurposing of a something used for Windows.
Yeah.
Something originally made to navigate documents and stuff. Well, kind of weird that. I mean, even when you got trackballs and stuff like that, they still haven't.
Computer keyboards were originally made to control a keyboard, though.
I'm
PC.
Talking about the mouse.
Oh, hang on. They were both the wrong words. I meant a computer. So keyboards came around, you know, mainframe days, even old Commodores, you know, things like that. They've always been around, and the function keys are to do certain things on certain systems. We don't use them as much as on PC. We don't use them as much as some of the older systems did. Mm. You know, some of them are almost pointless these days, unless you're a developer, I think. But, you know, I don't know. I think I'm.
Which do you prefer, Chris?
Depends on the game I'm playing. For first-person shooters, definitely 100% keyboard. 100%.
There's only, I don't know. I can't think of many genres of games that I would prefer a pad over. The only one I can think that comes to head is like a racing game.
Third-person action. Things like Gears of War, things like Assassin's Creed. I much prefer those on pads.
I still prefer a keyboard and a mouse because you've still got that element of aiming there.
Yeah.
And wherever there's aiming involved, wherever look accuracy is important, a mouse is always going to be better because it is... Unlike an analog stick, it's a true analog device.
Yeah,
it's determined by the speed of your hand. So the faster you want to go, the faster you move your hand.
Mm. Yep.
The same can't be said for analog sticks because you've got a boundary.
Yeah.
So you can only go hard right, and then you're kind of waiting for the camera to pan at its preset speed.
Yeah.
But you don't get that with a mouse, which is
unless you have a ridiculously high sensitivity on a pad, then it would work. But you'd need to be very, very accurate.
But then you lose your kind of fine control.
Mm. Whereas with the mouse, you've got the best of both worlds.
Sam, can you play with the mouse and keyboard then? Have you done that?
Yes, I have, but not for a long time. I did play the first Quake a little bit, and Quake 2, that was mouse and keyboard.
Right.
But I'm talking that was Quake 2 when it first came out, and I only played one player.
98, yeah.
Yeah, and the PC that we were running at the time, it was not good enough to play the game at full screen, so I had to play the game in a window. You know, sort of a window, sort of this.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know what you mean, yeah.
Oh, it's crazy. So, yes, I can, but I haven't done it for a long, long time.
Hmm.
But and I would agree with you, though, that there's no... I mean, even just talking about it, there's definitely no way that an analog stick is ever going to be as accurate as a mouse, because, yeah, a mouse is more or less... and a more accurate translation of your hand going where you want the cursor to go, whereas this is just a rough approximation that you're using in a small circular area with the joystick. That's what it is.
Mm. Do you feel like we could ever better that?
I don't know.
Control with your mind.
I would say that one of the things that first-person games still don't get right is the sense of feeling where you are in the world. So even, I don't imagine this is the same with a mouse and keyboard, but I've just been playing Far Cry 3 recently,
When you go into an area, obviously you can only see a certain field of vision. Now, as a human being in the real 3D world, I can sense where the sides of things are without having to see them because my peripheral vision picks it up, or I'm aware of it, whereas in a first-person game, you're not. So you find yourself hitting stuff and going, why can't I move? Oh, there's a tree to my left. Mm-hmm. But I didn't know it was there because I couldn't see it. So that's an issue that I don't think either of them have got past yet. But in terms of the accuracy of aiming, only full motion control where you're actually using a gun and pointing it at something. And even then, that depends on how good you personally are at aiming. So
exactly, yeah.
But no, you get better at aiming with a mouse. That's why you have pro gamers and you have people who aren't as good as pro gamers usually, you know? Because I can get out of practice if I don't play an FPS for a while.
A big disappointment for me was I went to America and I fired some guns and I was rubbish. I couldn't aim for shit.
I was
ace. Steve and another mate went there with me and they'd fired guns before and they knew how to use them. And I felt, because I played so many first-person shooters and I had quite a good aim in these first-person shooters, that would translate to me using a real gun. And it didn't at all. It was so disappointing.
I had a similar problem when I started learning to drive, and I was like, well, I played Grand Theft Auto, like, what's the problem?
Oh, whenever I get onto...
run over a prostitute.
Whenever I get onto GTA games, and I drive at the same, like, I'm going to work or whatever, I'm always thinking about them, and, like, wanting to do what I do in those games. It's so bad.
I was worried. When I started learning to drive, I was worried that I'd played so much Grand Theft Auto that I was going to automatically drive over people's lawns and go through red lights and run people over. I was
genuinely worried. Now you do it by choice, though, don't you?
And now that I know I can do it and get away from the coppers, now that I know that I can get away from 5 stars.
Yeah. As long as you've got 50 meters distance between you and... Yeah.
I know where all the spray garage is. It's brilliant.
So let's not spend this entire episode talking about how much better PCs are than consoles. We've already established that is the case, and let's move on.
A question, while we're still on the subject of control, what is the best gaming pad ever?
Of course, Sam.
Ever.
I know, this is that's a subjective thing, because most people would say that the Xbox 360 one is better. I think it's just because I've played PlayStations all my life, but I do prefer the PlayStation one. I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's any better. It just fits in my hand better, I guess. I don't know what it is. I always feel more comfy with it than I do when I played on Xbox.
I've got a theory behind the why a lot of people think that the Xbox controller is better.
Microsoft are better at marketing?
No. Totally thumb position. If you're playing any iteration of the PlayStation joypad and you're controlling it as you would, you control it with the buttons and an analog stick mainly. So you've got one thumb higher than the other.
Mm.
When you're playing, if it's 360, the analog stick's in the place where the D-pad is on the PlayStation pad, so your thumbs are actually at the same height. It means you can play longer, more comfortably.
Right, so yes.
Juggle him, Chris.
Who don't know what these two control pads look like, this is what they look. Well, this is a DS4, DualShock 4, and this is a 360 pad because I haven't got an Xbox One yet. There's you can see the analog stick on this one is a different heights, and you're right, I think that's probably why.
That's my theory anyway.
That is probably why.
I'm inclined to agree. I tried to play Half-Life on my PS2 with the PlayStation 2 pad, and my left thumb was aching like hell after about an hour, because it's in an unnatural position. It's like they were an afterthought. The analog sticks were an afterthought to the pad. The pad was designed for the D-pad. So when the Xbox pad came out and it was designed for that type of game...
Which was a copy off the Dreamcast joypad.
Was it?
Right.
Yeah.
This pad fills my hands much more comfortably. It fills them like how I would want to hold them if I was holding a control pad.
But Chris likes his hands being filled, by the way.
But this one has got... I mean, you're right. The thumb positions feel a bit low anyway in general, I think. Unless I move my fingers down a bit, then I don't have as much control over the pad. I've got, it's, and also I don't have there's space between the pad and my pad. You know, it's but this one, it just fills it up. So I think that's what it is. And mine is the 360 controller. I haven't tried the Xbox One, so I don't know.
Have you ever tried the original Xbox controller?
Yeah, and I don't like it. I really don't like it, but it's certainly no worse than any of Nintendo's controllers ever.
It's like holding a fucking planet. It's the biggest pad.
Xbox controller was made for massive Americans.
You know what? I should have brought them all upstairs. I've got all of these. I've got all the pads for all these consoles.
I think.
Go and get them if you want.
For a long time, I felt like the original PlayStation pad, the non-dual shock, was the best pad. It was so beautifully ergonomic. After all those days of playing on like the NES pad and stuff, which is not ergonomic at all. It's a rectangle in your hands. And even the SNES one wasn't that great. It was too small.
Yeah.
And then the PlayStation pad just it fit your hands so well, but it was to a purpose. It was for the games on the PlayStation. And then as soon as like the first person shooter and the third person and games where you needed analog on your left hand started to become prevalent, then the Xbox 360 pad did it for me. And I think to this day the Xbox 360 pad is the best all-rounder.
From what I've played, I would say yes. Now, in terms of control pads that are based on a particular system, I mentioned Nintendo pads a minute ago. Now, not a lot of serious or pro like gamers or people who consider themselves serious, at least, not a lot of people like that. The Wii controller.
I don't think it.
Now, yeah. I think the buttons are in a really awkward place, but for certain games, such as Skyward Sword, for example, it really feels good. It really works. And I also found Alan Wake, which I played on the Wii originally, I found that really good because you had the flashlight in one hand, and that was quite cool because it was all flashlights, mostly anyway. I didn't bother with the guns and much in that game.
It don't do much damage.
No, you might as well just run.
I thought Alan Wake was an Xbox exclusive, was it not? I thought it was exclusive to the Xbox. No? Okay.
You might be right there. I might be lying entirely.
I'm sure it came out for other consoles.
Oh, you know what? No, I'm not thinking that. I'm thinking of that Frozen...
Shattered Memories.
Shattered Memories, which, again, that was a flashlight. Sorry, I must have played them roughly the same time, but yeah, I have got Alan Wake for the 360. Embarrassing. But no, yeah, it was the fact that you had the flashlight and there was nothing else. You didn't actually get guns in that game, so it was all that, and you had, yeah, it's good. I liked it.
It's very like fit to a purpose, isn't it? It's like if you play an arcade game, you really want to play it on a big chunky arcade pad with a big knobbly stick and some big flat buttons to get the most out of it. Like if you try to play Street Fighter, you can play it on a pad, but you wouldn't want to play it on a pad. You'd want to play it on an arcade controller.
I don't know. I quite like playing Street Fighter 2 on the SNES on the pad.
It's easier to pull off the special moves with a stick, though.
Yes,
you're
it is.
You're totally right there. D-pad is impossible to pull off some of the moves in. Well, for me, it was anyway.
I remember that being a problem when I played Street Fighter 2. That's like, why can't I do the Hadouken? Do the Hadouken? Do the Hadouken? Do the Hadouken?
Yeah. Yeah.
Mortal Kombat was like that. Some of the finishing moves that you, and the things you had to do and the pixel preciseness of where you had to do them meant they were, I mean, I guess justifiably rock hard.
Yeah.
Because when you did finally pull them off, it was like, yes!
But that wasn't all just about the pad, though, was it? That was more about the game.
There's a pad as well. I mean, I played it on the Mega Drive, and the D-pad on the Mega Drive wasn't great either. Oh, go away!
It's back to super speed.
Although, I mean, this brings up another issue. There's the official pad that you get with the system, but there's always the sort of knockoff, not the knockoff ones, but there's always the third-party ones.
Never found now, one that's any good, though.
But I did for the Mega Drive. I had a third-party Mega Drive controller that was vastly superior because, it's hard to describe, but the D-pad was one unit, not four buttons.
Yeah.
So it was always like a little analog stick, but flat. So
like you could do the
Yeah.
Like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly like that. It was like that, and that made doing special moves on Mortal Kombat a lot easier.
I don't think I've once used that.
The funny thing I remember about those pads, though,
I was just thinking then, I've just checked news, but the Mega Drive had a single piece one.
It did, yeah.
Or is that what it was? I thought it was the third party one that I had. Oh, sorry.
Well, the third party ones are similar, but I remember the third party sticks for any console back then, or pad, sorry. They'd be this, roughly the same, but they'd have a trillion buttons on them. Like, more buttons on the keyboard. It's like, this is official, or almost official, but better, because it's got 8 switches and 15 buttons and panels and...
Worst pad ever.
Worst pad.
The touch-sensitive one that I had that actually physically made you ill. That was the worst
was
controller
it
ever.
You?
No, it just had like a little yellow pad with so you didn't actually. There was no buttons to press. It was all touch sensitive.
What was it for?
It was the standard serial, so it would work on Mega Drive, Amiga, that type of thing.
Right.
But it was like you played for 15 minutes and you actually started feeling ill. To the point of where whenever Lou came round, I made him use that one and I used the proper one.
It was it had like little weird sort of contacts on it, so it was doing something quite overtly electrical with your hands when you were using it.
Like
you were
through you.
Yeah. So you're pressing these buttons and you just feel yourself getting motion sickness from not moving.
Hmm.
It's like, what the hell's going on here? The worst pad ever. I'm gonna say the Nintendo 64 pad. I hated that thing. Who's got three hands?
Worst
no one.
Ever.
Yeah.
No, you know what the intention was with it, which was pointless. You were supposed to be able to hold it normally. I never held that middle one ever for anything. But you're supposed to be able to hold it like that or hold it like that.
How did you play?
I'll leave you guys talking. I'm going to go and grab a load of my pads because it'll make a bit more.
Go on then.
We'll be able to actually describe things.
Plus, and you're going to juggle it as well.
I would have said that you only hold the middle one because that had the joystick on it. So you only hold it on the mid on. You'd only hold it like that, and this whole side was just useless.
Yeah,
so you'd hold it like this, and I don't know if it's the worst one, but it's probably the worst one that I've played with because.
So you can actually reach the analog stick,
but you don't want to
holding the outside. It's not massively comfortable, but it's doable.
How big are Chris's hands if he played like that? And how did he pull the trigger?
Z trigger.
That looks filthy, Steve. You're doing sexual things to that.
Oh my word.
I best stop, Chris will get annoyed.
Well, the master's away, the cat will play.
The main problem I had with it was when you were like playing GoldenEye or Zelda or anything, that pressing up on that joystick got really uncomfortable after a while because it dug into your finger.
That is quite a hard up as well.
Didn't it have like an octagon sort of pattern in it?
Yeah.
So it could slot into
Yeah.
The shape
of it dug into my thumb. I don't know if it's just me, but if you get a good like 6 hour Zelda session going on, you're pressing up a lot. And
I mean, there's no rubber on there either. It's just solid plastic. So
yeah, it was a thing, rigid, isn't it?
It's not ergonomic.
It's not. It seems like they tried to tackle a problem. Obviously, they made the first console that had really good 3D hardware in it. I mean, the PlayStation was the first proper 3D one, I guess. Well, I suppose there's a CDI and things like that as well, but the PlayStation was the one to popularize 3D, but it was the Nintendo 64 which actually said, we've got proper 3D games here, and they look good. And Mario 64 was the kind of flagship game which was completely 3D. Mm. And I think most of the games on the N64 were 3D, just constantly trying to reinforce that. But it was almost like the hardware had been figured out, but the pad hadn't. It seems a very inefficient way to approach that problem.
They had a bit of an issue because the SNES pad is the precursor to the PlayStation pad.
Yeah.
They were in works. Now, we probably all know this, but Nintendo and Sony were in works to develop a console together. And there was all sort of legal shenanigans. They were both kind of dickheads to each other. From what I've heard, it seems like Sony wanted to make it with discs and Nintendo didn't because they thought it would be too easy to pirate.
Yeah.
So Sony took what they could patent-wise, including the controller design, and went and made the PlayStation, and Nintendo went and made the N64. Now, I believe the PlayStation came out before the N64.
Did well before, yeah.
Quite before. So I think they had a problem. They'd already had a good pad, and then they couldn't use it, so they had to make another one, and it didn't.
That's interesting.
I mean, the console was a good console. I liked the N64, but that pad was not as good as the PlayStation pad.
Did you really like it? Did you do the Christmas morning... Nintendo 64!
No, because I didn't have... My experience of it was playing other people. My experience of Nintendo generally was playing other people's Nintendos.
Right.
So my friends had N64s that I played on. I've been a PlayStation kid like all the way through, pretty much. And I still consider the PS1 a better console than the N64 because it had a better back catalogue in general. That's just my personal opinion, though.
I'd say the PlayStation, the original PlayStation, has one of the best game catalogues of probably any console.
Mm. Yeah.
It's got a cracking catalogue. I mean, yeah, it's got a few stinkers, but it's got so many classic games. I don't know if that's because of the time it came out. It's almost like the music that you like is the sort of the music that came out in your teenage years. And yeah, the PlayStation was my teenage years console. And it feels like, you know, maybe it's a nostalgia thing, but it just feel like it had a really good catalogue of some really excellent and new games. Because we got used to the whole idea of these 2D arcade-style games for years and years beforehand. And then the PlayStation came along and delivered something completely new.
But there were actually still quite a lot of old arcadey games on the PlayStation that are really good.
Yeah.
There's actually quite a few good side-scrollers on there that are still cracking.
Yeah.
For me, the big thing with the PlayStation was having come from the likes of like the Mega Drive and the SNES, and it was kind of like it was more grown up. The titles on it, you know, you had adult titles on there. You had, you know, like 16 rated games, and you didn't get anything. I mean, you had gore, but it was 16-bit gore, which is, you know, the comedy gore.
Yeah, and things like games like Wipeout and stuff, they seemed like they were aimed at more grown-up. They weren't silly kids' games. I mean, it was a racing game, but it had a sort of almost a sinister edge to it, didn't it? With this, you could destroy the other races. I know Road Rash could do that as well, but it felt like it had that sort of like cutting-edge trance-like soundtrack of a real dance artist, I think.
And yeah.
It felt a more serious endeavor, didn't it, I think?
Yeah.
It wasn't a game anymore.
It was actually, you know, this is
experience.
Yeah.
Now that I think about it, you're right. It does feel like a coming of age for gaming, doesn't it? It feels almost like it was targeting the kind of 20 to 30 year old market instead of the 10 to 20 year old market, which has always been my bugbear with Nintendo, because Nintendo don't ever seem to have made that step. Nintendo never feels like it's grown up.
They know their market and they're going to keep to it, because even adults now go back to them. Chris has got a washing basket full of peripherals.
You were not kidding, were you? At all.
What the fuck?
Thank you. Yeah, I was just thinking that.
I muted myself a while back and I forgot to unmute myself.
How long have you been muted for? About half an hour?
I have no idea. I'm so sorry. I'm such a fucking knob.
Well, we'll find out when we try and watch it back later.
We were all being interesting for you, Chris. You were just holding up a basket full of controllers.
The thing is, though, there'll be a bit where you talk about that controller, you're just like, there'll be no sound to go with it.
I turned it off when I went downstairs because I didn't want to hear me having a wee, and I forgot to turn it on when I came back up, so everything I've said is pointless.
That was eight. Say it all again.
what is that called, that stupid thing?
The Move controller.
Move.
Oh, you mean the stupid ball thing on top of
it? Yeah, it looks like a dildo.
Yeah, this stupid...
What kind of dildos have you been using?
Those ones.
With big ball legs on it.
You can inflate it.
Inside.
So, I hate myself.
We all hate you too. Yeah. Biggs has just called you a spaz as well. In the chat.
Smells.
So...
Because Luke's been using it as a dildo.
Dildo, yeah.
I thought you just washed it. You weren't supposed to smell it.
It sells incense all over it, I think.
All right.
Oh.
So what is the point of that then? What is that? Does that work like a...
PSI picks it up. It lights up. I was going to try and find a USB cable that's the right port. It's a mini one, not a micro one.
It's basically copying the Wii controller, right?
Yeah, but I mean... I've used it once, you know. I got it for a birthday present because I couldn't think of what to ask for someone, and then they got it for me, and I was like, yeah, all right, and put it down. I
was a grateful bastard.
No.
Hopefully that person won't be watching the stream.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. No, it wasn't. It wasn't that it was a bad present. It was a great present because I collect stuff like this, but it was still like, any good games? No. So... what's the point?
Well, wasn't when it launched, wasn't it meant to be that you sung into it? Did it have a microphone in it or something? There was a singing game.
No.
Yeah, that's a separate microphone.
Yeah,
that's
you get microphones for those. SingStar, there's another thing we can talk about in terms of peripherals.
God, there's not only that, but all the rock Guitar Hero stuff that followed on from it.
Yeah, musical controllers. Games. What do we think? Because I know you two are musicians, and I am to a certain degree.
I'm a drummer, let's get that. That's a slight... There's a slight branching off point there.
There's not much melody on a
but
drum kit.
There are, but I said musician, I didn't say the melodician. But there's drum kit controllers, isn't there? I mean, with Rock Band. Or
yeah, whatever. There are, yeah.
What do you guys think of them?
I think, in terms of for the very basics of rhythm keeping, they're actually a really good instrument. And I would say one thing as well, it probably had a positive effect on some people's lives, that they might have been exposed to different music than they would ever have given a chance to if it wasn't for Guitar Hero. Like some kid who likes, I don't know, likes Britney Spears or something, but plays Guitar Hero because it's a good game, then hears, I don't know, Guns N' Roses. I'm not saying Guns N' Roses are mint or anything, but at least it might have expanded some people's musical taste a little bit. Because I heard a few songs on Guitar Hero that I wouldn't have given a chance to and thought, actually, that's all right. And then looked into that band later and got a few of their songs or whatever. So that's, in its own way, is kind of positive. That's got nothing to do with the hardware. That's just the game as a general thing.
I never really thought, but that it does actually make a lot of sense when you think about it, because it kind of, the resurgence of rock music seems to... It's hard to tell whether they followed on from the fact that rock music was getting popular again, or the rock music gained more traction because of these games which were exposing young people to that music.
Don't Stop Believing. A few of the Dragon Force songs. You know, that those kind of songs became popular from, I think, from Rock Band regurgitating it all, and people then taking it and going, oh, this is popular, let's stick it in Glee or whatever else, you know, whatever else we're doing. And then all them bands started doing revival tours and going to do festivals and things like that. And you know, some of them were interesting to watch, but I felt they were a bit of a gimmick, a bit out of place, you know, kind of.
Yeah. Did we see Journey? Was it Sonosphere or Download?
It was Sonosphere. No, Download, that was.
Either way, it wasn't right, was it, really?
No. They shouldn't have done that.
But then there was also, you'd also get people that would talk about it, because it became a big thing amongst anybody who not only played an instrument but also played games. So you get like these guitarists every now and then who were into like the Killers and stuff, and they'd be like, oh, but you know, the actual more interesting stuff is that heavy metal shit. And you're like, yeah, like, yes, of course, it's got more stuff going on. Like, it's not just one chord for 5 hours. Do you know what I mean?
And some whiny, prancy fuckwit dancing around on a stage called Brandon Flowers.
Yeah.
Fuck off, mate.
It's not quite as whiny and prancy, but usually still a fuckwit shouting on a stage instead when it comes to metal.
Oh, well.
Anyway, metal versus indie, etc. Blah, blah.
Yeah. At least he can turn his microphone on, Chris.
Yeah. He doesn't turn his fucking microphone on. Some other prancy prat does it. He's probably got odd socks on because it's quirky. And a fucking... one of them stupid things. Fedora or triple. Tribbly?
Tribbly.
Tribbly.
Tribbly, tribbly.
Correct me.
Anyway, what we're talking about. Oh, yeah, the actual Guitar Hero thing. Yeah. The drums were kind of interesting, but they weren't set up like a real drum kit. And obviously, it was really weird when you were playing as well, if you could play the drums. So you play a song that you knew. Like, we did Black Hole Sun by Soundgarden, but I wasn't very good at the controller, so I'd play it on easy, but then I'd be hitting extra hits because I knew what the drums were supposed to be doing. So I'd be doing the kick hits that are actually in the song, but there's only like one every like bar. So it was a bit weird for me because I played real drums. It was
but
a bit
people
weird.
Like me who hadn't played much. I'm not a drummer. I couldn't, you know, I couldn't ever proclaim to be that. But I can at least get on a drum kit and do a dunch, 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 you know, that type of thing. But when I played the game, it introduces you in on easy, medium, hard, and expert, and you can get to the point by going through the campaign. You can get better and better and better the way they've organised it, and you could get to the point where you're really good at the controller. So that's why I think, well, obviously that's why they did it, but I understand, again, from your point of view, it must have been a bit frustrating at times.
But I didn't view that as a negative thing, because I was able to separate the difference between a real instrument and a sort of facsimile piece of equipment that was a computer game controller, essentially. I wasn't that into those games. I ever played it with you and other people. I never played it on my own, really.
Yeah, I did play it on my own a fair bit, actually.
some guitarists and musicians were like, oh, it's like a travesty. It's like, it really isn't. Like,
it's just
it's
game,
a computer
mate.
Game.
Yeah.
Like, come on, get down off your high horse a little bit with this.
You don't see the soldiers having a go at Call of Duty. probably do. Like
they probably do.
They play it. A lot of them play it, don't they?
Well, there's armor, isn't it? With the, which is the official army sort of training regime made into a game. America's Army and
Oh, I've heard about that. That's like a shady sort of recruitment enterprise.
It is,
type
yeah.
Deal.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's no, getting into, that. they're getting into dodgy territory with that one, aren't they, really?
Is it, like really Call of Duty, to... join the army.
Yeah.
You can save wherever you want.
If you kill enough people, you'll get a new gun.
So I've said enough about Guitar Hero. Chris, you've played it more than I did, so what do you reckon?
I loved it. I really, really loved it, and I'd still play it now if I had the time, you know? I think it was kind of therapeutic to play, and a lot of fun with friends as well, as long as your friends weren't too competitive. Because if you get... I'm not a particularly competitive person. I like a bit of banter, but when it comes to winning, I couldn't care less if I win or not, I'll be honest with you. I'm just doing it for the enjoyment of the moment, you know, most of the things I do. So, yeah, when I play games with people who are a bit competitive, I get a bit narked about it and get like, fucking hell, mate, just enjoy it, fuck off.
Yeah.
But they're enjoying it in their own way. Anyway, sorry, going off subject entirely there.
Recall one very, very funny rendition of Living on a Prayer when you were singing. It was absolute comedy genius. It's so funny, but
not only Bon Jovi, but Bon Jovi by Chris. That's the second level of hell.
It was a moment that needed to be recorded for all to see, but unfortunately, I don't think we did.
No.
Going back a little bit, and off the topic of controllers, what was your first console or computer? Yeah, your first introduction to kind of gaming.
My first ever introduction to gaming was a Binatone that my dad got from a car boot sale. And he used to do that all the time. He used to buy old computers and if one of his computers broke, like his Commodore or his VIC-20, he'd just go and buy another one and replace the actual base unit and all the peripherals would still work, you know. But yeah, I think it was that. Or an Atari 2600.
Right.
One of those two.
I can't even remember the Binatone. I've heard the name, but I can't remember what it is.
The first one that I actually owned, my first memory of a game and a console, I might have even mentioned a PC thing, whatever, computer. I'm a programmer as well. You'd think I know what they are by now. The first memory that I have of opening something that was bought for me, brand new, that wasn't a piece of junk that we had to keep replacing, was a Commodore 64. And it was I actually opened the tape first, and it was Postman Pat, the game.
Right.
It was amazing. Brilliant game.
I've got a kind of a smeary memory of my first one that I owned was an Atari 2600 that I somehow managed. I had a game called Adventure on it where you were a block and you had to collect some keys and avoid some dragons. And I managed to find my way out of the world and crash the cartridge.
Nice.
So that kind of set the standard for gaming thereon. But I also really remember going to Steve's house and playing on his Acorn Electron.
I remember playing on an Acorn Electron and a BBC Micro at school, like up in the IT department, which was like no one went there. You know, there was everyone had to do one lesson a week or something, and everyone was like, oh, I don't want to go near computers. But we used to spend dinner times playing Yellow Brick Road.
I remember that. Granny's Garden and...
Yeah.
Yeah,
I had that at my school as well.
I'm glad it wasn't just me, because I keep trying to find it online and I can't, you know, when we do our other shows and it's like, can't see it anywhere, can't find any evidence that it existed.
The computer room at school used to be a load of BBC Micros welded into some box section tables that were like 8 tons, and it'd be like 5 of them in a room.
the year that I left my secondary school and went to college, they got PCs. Like before that, it was all my BBC Micros and stuff. But it'd be Windows 3.1.
I did have PCs in secondary school. That's how backwards my skills were.
Yeah, your school was often on fire.
It was, yeah.
Yeah.
I think I'm the same with you guys. I think the first computer that I actually remember having was a 2600. But I grew up with two older brothers, and I used to basically just get a stream of hand-me-downs. So the first ever computer that was specifically bought for me was an Amiga 500.
Cool. And I hated you for that.
I would have hated you if I knew you, because my two of my friends had Amigas and I was stuck on a Commodore 64. And I was so envious because it was so much better. The graphics, the fact it had Workbench built into it, the fact that it was... there was porn on it as well. The first porn I ever saw. It was amazing.
Two discs.
I don't want to go too far, but the first porn I ever saw was also on an Amiga 500. So.
Yeah. Stag.
Yes, Stag.
And then Son of Stag.
Yeah, Son of Stag, Stag 2 and Son of Stag. I think that must have been going around Teesside in general, I think.
Yeah, it must have been.
I'm hoping again other people had access to that. And it wasn't just some shady dude who created it just for Teesside.
He used to give discs to kids that you wanted to use. Yeah.
I don't even know where it came from. It was a friend's. It was on a friend's Amiga. And Yeah.
Biggs has just got
Biggs
it.
Biggs has just said it as well. Biggs, for anybody else who's watching, Biggs is one of our friends from LAN party days. And
you went to college with him, didn't you, Chris?
Yes.
You went to big college.
College was a mess for me. I was distraught through the entire of college, worrying about my girlfriend dumping me and stuff, which she'd just done when I went to college. So I spent the entire time going, oh, I hate college, I hate my life. Yeah,
Chris turned emo for about 2 years.
Yeah.
Yeah. He dyed his beard black.
I didn't have a beard back then.
He became an emo pirate.
Yeah.
So, Sam, what about you?
I'm trying to remember if it's the first one. I think Mega Drive is the first console that I had, but I've got a feeling one before this was like one of those little like a handheld game that you put up to your eyes to play with like two buttons on top. One was like you could move and fire, and it was like a tank game where you had like if you had the display was like a tank at the bottom. Was and it was like there and there, and you shot at those. They look like the ships from Tron. They came up the screen like that, like towards you, and you had to like shoot them. I think I had that before the Mega Drive, and that was just like a one game. That game was just that. You couldn't take out the cartridge and put a new one in. It was just that one game.
I do remember that.
Was it
black and red?
Yes.
Like red at the end with kind of like a translucent section, a life.
Yes. Road. And my sister had the same one, but it was you were a diver and it was sharks coming at you.
Oh, I remember that
the
one.
Same thing. And then I think we both had those at the same time before we got the Mega Drive after much hounding of my parents to get one. Because Sonic the Hedgehog had come out and my friends were all getting them. Like, all my friends at primary school, we all had Mega Drives together. Hmm. So it was class because you'd all, like I'm guessing you guys did, or with your friends when you were at school.
No.
You'd all swap each other's games. Like if one of you had, you know, a RoboCop game or whatever, and what if you had Quackshot, you'd swap it, like, it didn't matter, you just...
Yeah, oh, okay, yeah, we did actually, yeah, but I didn't have many people who had my consoles. I had Nintendos, and I don't know if that was posh or not for my area, but everyone else had, like, Mega Drives.
We tend to have different stuff for the majority of our childhood, Lou.
I was always behind. I had a Spectrum when you had an Amiga. I didn't get my Mega Drive until I was well into secondary school. I got a hand-me-down one.
Jesus.
Not a hand-me-down one, but it was a second-hand one that I bought with a load of games. But it was the best Mega Drive because it was a universal PAL Mega Drive, so it could play Japanese games on it.
Yeah, I heard that about Mega Drive.
Brilliant. I've still got it somewhere, and it's the best Mega Drive. You can put any game from any region in it, and it plays it.
That's pretty cool.
And I got some proper, genuine Japanese games with it that had like the full color printed manuals and everything. Absolutely brilliant. That's not an official one, is it?
Yep.
Yep.
It is.
Must be a later one then.
I think there were later ones. There was because there was a Mega Drive 2, if you remember, that came out that had just a slightly different design, and I don't think it was any different.
It was different actually. I usually came with a game built in. Like, what game did it have built in? Is it Sonic?
Which one?
There was a Mega Drive 2 with
built-in
games.
No, the Master System 2 came with a built-in game.
Had Alex Kidd built into it.
Yeah, but I thought Mega Drive had some built-in games too.
No.
All right, okay.
There might have been a version.
It was an inferior machine. It didn't have a headphone jack and a few other things as well.
Yeah, but did you really need a headphone jack because the TV had a headphone jack?
It did, but you had stereo sounds and some of the music was great. You're going to get mono from coax.
Did they have stereo music on the Mega Drive?
Yeah.
What if you used composite instead of coax?
The coax on the back of the Mega Drive was just a standard aerial connector, which is mono.
No, but on the Mega Drive 2, it was composite.
Was it?
Yeah.
I can't remember. I thought it was just a coax again. Yeah, well.
Sure it was.
Are you sure coax can't... Coax is fibre. It can handle whatever.
The aerial specification is mono.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure of it. Mm. You have to plug your stereo headphones or speakers into the front of the Mega Drive to get stereo music.
I didn't know that. If that is the case, I thought it took stereo. It carried stereo. But
Biggs has just mentioned the PC Mega Drive hybrid, which is called the
Mega PC.
Mega PC. Was it Amstrad that made that?
I played that in Dixon's in Middlesbrough.
It was basically a Mega Drive inside a PC with a cartridge slot in the front of it, and it was worse than both of them put together. It was a terrible PC with a Mega Drive stuck in it.
Thanks, Amstrad.
Thanks.
One of my friends called Stuart had that, and he had Discworld on it, the Terry Pratchett game.
Yeah.
And we could never figure out what we needed to do on it. I didn't play it that much, but he also liked the blue tones, and I didn't back then, so he was obviously a dick. Hey?
So
I like the blue tones.
I like them now. I'm just like back then I didn't.
Isn't Amstrad, is that Alan Sugar Amstrad?
Yep, Alan Sugar. Yeah. What a twat.
What? I want a Mega Drive in a PC. Don't want any bullshit.
We're not gonna work, Alan. Fuck off, you're fired.
Well, hang on, what is that actually one of his enterprises from originally?
Yeah, Amstrad.
He is Mr. Amstrad. Didn't he start that company?
Wow.
That's where he made his fortune.
I've got an ounce more respect for him now.
No, don't have respect. Right, okay, I was a Sinclair Spectrum owner, right? I was a Sinclair owner, and Amstrad bought Sinclair out, Sinclair Research, in 1986, and ruined Sinclair. Amstrad is the reason that we still aren't playing on Sinclair machines now. I hate Alan Sugar for that. He's a bastard. And anyone who's a Sinclair Spectrum fan will be with me on this, because all of the magazines that used to read were all anti-Amstrad. It was all kind of Alan Sugar propaganda. What a twat he is. We want Sir Clive Sinclair back.
Well, I've learned two things today. Jesus.
Yeah, he bought out Sinclair and he made a few new machines, which were basically hybrids of Amstrad's CPCs and Sinclair's own stuff. Then he made the CPC 464 and thought, right, sod it, I'm not going to bother keeping the Sinclair name going. Let it die. And you know what? I could let him die quite happily. I wouldn't piss on him if he was on fire.
Aren't Amstrad's like notoriously or just always like a bit wank? But they've always just been not the computer you want to get.
So they improved the keyboard on it, and that was it. That was the only thing that they made better on the Sinclair Spectrum, the whole name.
I'm sure I played on an Amstrad. I don't have one. I actually forgot they even existed, I'll be honest with you. But I think I played Mr. Puniverse on it, on an Amstrad. If you ever
is that like a fighting game set in a church?
What?
Mr. Pew? On a pew? Oh. Or a weightlifting game set in a church?
It was like a Manic Miner, a Jet Set Willy type thing. It was, you jumped around and you had to just get through 2D screens, and that was it. It, from my recollection, but again, it was one of those that we played a lot as a kid, but never really got very far on it.
I wonder why.
That seems to be the recurring theme here with older games.
Certainly in my memory, I remember me and a friend called Anthony used to sit around. In fact, me and Steve used to do it as well, actually. We'd sit around with these games that you invariably on the computers rather than the consoles, and just sit around for hours not knowing what to do. One of my mates mentioned a game called Nightmare for the Sinclair Spectrum, and we could never get out the second room.
I completed Nightmare.
We'd load it, it'd take about 8 minutes to load, and we'd just load it up and then try and figure out how to get out the second room for 2 hours and then give up.
I had it on the Commodore 64, and because I love Nightmare the Show so much, it is the
game
of the show,
yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I love the show so much, I played it so much that I did actually complete that. I can't remember what happens at the end. Probably Traeguard goes, bye.
Well, don't you, in the show, they used to walk off down the path into the sunset, didn't they?
Yeah.
Or was that when they died?
I never saw anybody complete the show ever.
No, because it was completely unfair. It was like,
no,
if you didn't pick up the right
morons. It wasn't that they were completely off. They were mostly idiots. You watch it now.
They were 7 years old.
Yeah. but
no excuse.
One of the first puzzles in Nightmare, and I'm sorry we're going off on a bit of a tangent, but one of the first puzzles in Nightmare was that you come across a table with about 10 objects on it, and you had to pick two of them. And if you didn't pick the two right objects for some puzzle later on that you weren't privy to, you would die. It's like, oh, you didn't pick up the gem and the cup, and you've come across this thing where you need the gem and the cup. Sorry, you're dead.
The cup gem monster.
You must cup his gem.
And then gem his cup.
So, yes, hardware.
Well, I was going to go back. What do we think about handhelds? Do we have any fond memories of handhelds? Is there a reason why we think handhelds haven't really taken off until the mobile generation?
Before we move on, I'm just going to read out something Biggs has just put in the channel. Oh, one of my favourite pieces of gaming hardware is the big sheet of cardboard separating two monitors when playing Duke Nukem 1 versus 1 over serial cable on PCs next to each other. Yeah. Yes, you know what? I can take it one step further than that. On when playing GoldenEye, which is cut down in the four sections on the screen on the N64, putting card in between each one and getting people to stand and sit in the relevant areas.
People hanging.
It didn't work at all, but it ruined my TV because it was covered in fucking it was obviously got red hot, the old CRT tube TVs, and it'd just stick the sellotape to the front of it.
Steve, you've still got the cable there. Steve and I used to play Link Up Doom, with that. Many years ago now.
I don't think I've ever played a Link Up with anybody.
But that was a lot better because you could have two TVs and they'd be like back to back.
Yeah.
It still took some setting up.
I think I did play Link Up, but I've no memories of it. You know, I don't think I ever.
I think
I had mates who had the same consoles that we could. I mean, I know someone who had a NES at the same time as me, but they didn't have Link Up on.
No, they didn't. But the problem was you had to lug your console and the TV to your mate's house usually.
Yeah, and it's the TV. Mum, can I borrow?
I'm just going to borrow the TV for a few hours.
I think we did at one point try and think of a way that we could maybe string the cable between our houses.
Yeah,
because it's only like 50 feet between houses, or something, if that.
Lots of sellotape tying all these cables together.
Seriously considering it. We're measuring it.
I used to do things like that with my mates. I'd be like, "Well, we can run a cable or something, or we could do, you know, we could have walkie-talkies and talk to each other at night and stuff." But then invariably, they'd go home with my other walkie-talkie, forget to turn it on, or it'll be too far away and it wouldn't.
Oh, the best thing is you get it working. All right. Alright.
Yeah. What are you doing?
We had a good night tonight, didn't we?
See you later. Bye. See you at school tomorrow. Oh, have you done your homework? Fuck off.
Yeah, sorry. Handhelds.
Yeah. Handhelds. Indeed.
Yeah, fuck handhelds.
Yeah, I'm...
No, seriously.
I don't have anything against them, apart from the fact that, like, I just don't want to play a game like that. I want to sit on the couch or somewhere comfy and be like, big screen, sound, all that shit.
That there was on the PSP.
I was pissed off when that came out.
Was it Vita or PSP?
PSP.
That came out and it was a serious part of the franchise and it was important to the story. They cut down a lot of gameplay things as far as I'm aware. I haven't played it, so I don't know yet. But when they brought it out, it was like, why just... Why would I want to buy that if I'm into my game consoles? Why would I want to buy a handheld? And they were just trying to prime us for this next generation.
Yeah.
That's all they were doing.
We're trying to shift to PSP.
I bought a PSP for one game, and that was the Twisted Metal, I can't remember, the Hardline, I think it was, which was like a true successor to Twisted Metal 2 on the PlayStation. All the other Twisted Metal games that had come out on the PS2 were rubbish. And that one was really good. So I bought it just for that, and I barely used it. But the weird thing is that all these handhelds never really took off, but then mobile...
The DS really is massive, mate.
I was going to say the DS did.
Well, the DS, yeah, but that came after the mobile revolution, though, didn't it?
Not the gaming revolution. It was around before games really kicked off on mobiles. Remember, games on mobiles are pretty recent. I remember getting this Samsung Galaxy S2, which was the first dual-core processor phone, I think. It was the same, you know, the first release. And they're the only ones that you could really start playing decent games on. Before that...
Biggs has mentioned the original Game Boy, and I completely forgot about that.
Yes, okay, I had two of those, and me and my family played them so much. And literally, we had three games. I had Zelda, the one on the island. Zelda, the one on the island. I had Tetris, and I had Super Mario World? Super Mario Land? Land, I think it was.
Land it was, yeah.
And again, all brilliant games, but...
Do you remember the little light thing you got for the original?
The magnification square.
Yeah, terrible, wasn't it?
Terrible. Yeah. I actually quite enjoyed it. Well, I've got quite a few handhelds, and I firmly believe that they've got their place in gaming.
Yeah, I know.
I don't believe that they replicate mainstream gaming. Like, you can't get a handheld to do what a console can do. You can't get a handheld to do what a PC can do. But there's still a lot of miles in the old style of gaming that the handhelds can do very well.
You know,
like top-down games, puzzle games, RPGs to a certain extent.
If I didn't write code so much, like basically my life is writing code at work and then writing code at home. If I didn't do that, I would have probably got into handhelds more as I got older, because I'd have loved to buy a PSP or a Vita just because there's some games on it that I wanted to play, but I wouldn't just sit and play them at home. I'd never do that. It would always be while I'm in the dentist waiting to get my teeth done, or while I'm on the train, or, you know, while I'm doing something. And I don't have much of that time in my life, so that's why I don't really play them.
So, did everyone have a Game Boy?
I had one, yeah.
I didn't. They were given that I had a Mega Drive, it was too expensive to have one of them as well.
80 quid, they were.
I only had one game for my Game Boy, and that was Tetris. I think that, again, was a second-hand buy. I don't remember buying it new. But all I played on it was Tetris.
I played Game Boys, but I never owned one.
Yeah, I mean, there was kind of like two revolutions of handheld gaming. Because I remember there being two big fusses kicked up about colour handheld gaming.
Game Gear.
Your Game Gear, Atari Lynx, Neo Geo Pocket Color, which all came out massively before the latest iteration of a kind of handheld color gaming.
And it was even what was that one? The go on, I'll try and think about it.
What one?
There was another one which was like an indie one that was released where you could program
continue.
For it.
Continue.
There was the GP32.
Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah, the Game Pack or the Game Park.
Game Park.
That was like a Chinese
Korean.
One, wasn't it?
Korean. It was.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah, you've kind of got my train of thought now. But yes, I think they're definitely relevant and they've definitely got a place in gaming. Like the latest Zelda for the 3DS. It's fantastic.
What is it?
I've heard that's very, very good.
A Link to the Past. No, a Link Between Worlds. Sorry.
I was going to say that was in the 90s, that one.
Yeah. No, but it is really good.
We've got a DS. Do you have to have like the most recent version for the game?
It's got to be a 3DS.
I'm not sure if we've got a 3DS or a DS. I'll have a look, but I might get it. I might get that game if it's that good. But I've only got time for so much gaming, and that's, again, I don't really consider those real proper time investment games, you know? They feel more like casual games, again, like mobile games to me.
Yeah, but casual games have their place, like you say, when you're on the train, when you're travelling, when you're on holiday and you're waiting in the airport, you know.
When you're having a poo, let's just say it.
When you're having a shit.
Yeah.
There is an appeal to it. I mean, when I bought my PSP, I was really looking forward to trying to get Final Fantasy VII on it. Now, I think since then, there is an official version of it that you can download on the PSP. I'm pretty sure you can do it, yeah.
But you can download stuff from the network onto your PSP. Well, your PSP you can. I don't know about PSP.
I'm sure there's a handheld version of Final Fantasy VII, which is just a direct port to one of the... I don't know if it's PSP or the PS Vita, but I'd love that. I'd love to be able to carry Final Fantasy VII around with me. I think that'd be brilliant.
I said that it appeals to me, but I just wouldn't have the time to do anything with it.
You'd make the time, you'd use it as a casual machine. Like you say, you're on the train, you're having a poo, you know, all those parts of the day where you're not doing anything else, you can just fire the game up, play a little bit, and stuff like that would be ideal for it.
You don't understand. I really don't have that though. Unless I'm happen to be working in somewhere like Manchester or Liverpool, and I want to get the train in every morning instead of drive, then.
So what do you do when you're having a poo?
I play casual games on my tablet. So I've got my tablet in the toilet, and I play Angry Birds, I play Lasers, I play...
So you are playing mobile games?
Yeah, yeah, I did say that earlier, but everyone kept talking over me. I was saying I do play casual games. I don't see the point in paying a fortune for a handheld console, because I don't consider those... It's kind of that middle... It's kind of medium gameplay. It's not casual, and it's not good games. I don't know, I can't really...
They are good games, though.
Big said the same thing, though, Chris, and I think he agrees with it. Mythlaw said it, that you're spending a lot of money on a machine which is just about games, whereas if you've got a phone or a tablet, it does everything else, and it just happens to play games as well and be handy.
Yeah, but if you look at the price of a phone, let's say an iPhone, for example, being probably the most popular, you're talking, what, £500-600?
Yeah.
Yeah, but you can get them free on
contracts.
Yeah, you're getting free on contract, but you're still paying for it. It's higher purchase.
Yeah, yeah.
If you were to get, let's say, a 3DS on your credit card and pay off the minimum payment, you'd be paying less for it, and it's only, what, £150?
Mm. Yeah, but you can't do everything else with a 3DS you can with a phone. But I don't know. All right, maybe I don't know why I don't like handhelds, but they don't appeal to me. They don't feel like I'm gaming. If I want a game, I either start something up on my PC, which is the easiest way to do things at the moment.
And get shit all over your chair.
A what?
And get shit all over your chair.
Because you can't have a poo while you're on your PC.
Alright. Sorry, that one just went straight over my head then. No idea what you're talking about. I'll set in my mind, right, tonight is going to be console night, and I'm going to go and sit downstairs, pull my chair back, play all night, you know? And that's the only way that I game these days. It's either as much as I can on PCs, you know, when I'm not programming, or dedicating time to console games downstairs. Mm. So maybe, I don't know, maybe handhelds are ideal for me. Maybe I'd be able to play more games if I had a handheld, but...
Has anyone seen the Pandora handheld?
No.
Is that... Go on.
It's a handheld Linux system. I've put a link to it in the document.
I'm just looking. Now, it looks like a DS with a keyboard.
Yeah.
Instead of a bottom screen.
Basically, yeah. But it allows you to run emulators and things like that on it.
Is it powerful enough to run the emulators decently, though?
It's supposed to be. I've never actually used one.
Hmm. That'd be interesting.
It looks like a PDA.
Mm.
It looks a lot like a DS to me.
The screen is like a DS XL.
Yeah.
Mm. I mean, this is another thing, isn't it? You've got the whole slew of indie consoles now. You've got stuff like the Ouya and things like that.
Yeah.
Which aren't really gaining that much traction. There's a lot of them. A lot of them are getting kickstarted, but then they're just disappearing into the ether.
Well, there's only so many things you can play Angry Birds on before you get sick of it.
Or Worms, or, you know.
Well, these aren't Angry Birds. These are machines which you can play indie games on, so...
Yeah,
or maybe that's a problem. Maybe it's stuff like Towerfall Ascension and things like that.
The thing is with indie games is... I mean, as someone who came from not knowing anything about indie games to becoming an indie developer and getting really involved and buying shed loads of them, before that, I didn't really pay much attention to the indie scene. We're getting a bit off topic, I think, with that. Indie consoles, maybe that's what their problem is, I suppose, in terms of the hardware. And plus, they haven't got the backing of Microsoft and Sony and Nintendo, you know, these behemoths.
Marketing.
That's what it is. I mean, as soon as there's a new Nintendo game out that they want to target at the West, we all know about it these days. Everybody. And your nan knows about it, you know? You're never going to get that with an indie console.
But the presence at the gaming expos as well, the E3s and the PAX and the Tokyo Game Show, it's like all that sort of stuff that gets all the coverage, which we're all probably, at some extent, fed into on the internet by YouTube or whatever you want to look at, that stuff's not really represented there very much.
Mm.
Not covered very much.
No, because the stands cost an absolute fortune. You're looking at 20, 30 grand just for a stand at those things. You know, you can go to little conventions like... I got invited to one in Blackpool that was... I think it was 150 quid for indie stands. And I went into the indie place, and some of the stands are great, but it was indie, you know. Each one was different, and each one was kind of... You know, it was nowhere near as big as the big players that are as elaborate, because there's only one guy or two guys doing it, you know.
I think one of the things as well is if you are a consumer and you are looking at buying some hardware, it is an investment, and you've got a lot more confidence with the likes of Microsoft, Nintendo, Sony that you are going to get good titles in the future rolling on.
And you're going to get support going on.
You are
going
to get support if you buy like the Ouya. They're like you. I can't even pronounce it. Ouya. That Lou mentioned, then you are dependent on the indie market, and what's going to happen there? It's much more unpredictable.
Yeah,
totally. Because at the moment, it had a bit of a boost a while back, and it seems to be lulling at the moment a little bit. And I don't know which way it's going to go.
They've kind of come out on the promise of stuff like Minecraft, and what they haven't realised is that Minecraft gets bought by the big players. Anything in the indie scene that comes out and gets big, instantly becomes. Incorporated into something that's big like Microsoft.
Yeah.
And so there's a steal. It's like the PS4. A lot of the stuff that they advertise on the PS4 now is indie stuff.
Hmm.
It's gone straight up to the top.
But so it doesn't matter if it's indie or not, but it means
that any of the good games.
If it's good and a big company gets behind it, it doesn't really matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if it's indie or it's AAA.
But it means for these indie consoles is that they're getting the dregs, they're getting the stuff that's left over.
Hmm.
And so they're never going to propagate.
Well, it's like some of the other distribution platforms, like, you know, Steam has all of the big titles and all of the, you know, it has Greenlight and everything else that goes on with it. But there's a lot of other distribution platforms that I look through. They're dead cheap, but they haven't got any games that I want to buy. Mm. They don't look that interesting, you know. But anyway, again, kind of pushing ourselves onto indie here, and we're talking about hardware. So
can I move the subject on briefly to VR and what people think of VR and whether they think it's here to stay?
You mean Virtual Boy, that weird...
I'm talking about the newer stuff like the Oculus.
Yeah, I thought you were. Pending purchase.
Yeah.
I've already mentioned that. I just want to know what other people think of it, because it is a piece of hardware that looks like it's either going to make big waves or it's going to come and go away like 3D movies did.
My opinion is it's been tried several times in the past and has failed. Mm-hmm. There's going to be a lot of pressure, because a lot of people are just going to be prepared to discount it straight away as something that will never work. So they've got a lot of pressure on them. I've seen the hardware and I've had talks with you about it, and it all seems very good on paper. But the only thing that's going to sell it to me is when I put it on and it feels right.
Every single person that I've spoken to that has tried an Oculus Rift has had that opinion, that they beforehand they were skeptical. When they put it on, wow, this can work. This can be it this time round. There's been a few reports of people being, you know, getting motion sickness and or VR sickness, as they call it. There's been a few issues of people walking into things, and because they've been so immersed in the world. But it's the immersion that these new headsets give you over the old ones. They're a lot more comfortable to wear. That's one of the main things. Bearing in mind that not just technology's moved on, lifestyle has moved on as well, and you know, people want comfort and people want convenience, and if they can do that easily, then I think it may take off. I'm still not sold yet. I haven't tried a VR though, so...
I think if it works, it's at the right price point.
Biggs just kind of put it on the head. I can't be bothered. I'm a little bit like that myself. I'm, you know, as much as I'd love to get the Oculus Rift developer kit and have a play with it, I've got no real use to do that at the moment. There's no real benefit to me apart from it's cool to play with. But I can't see it. I can't see me coming up with any kind of VR game that would actually sell or would be interesting to a mass market. Plus, then you're limited by hardware sales. And as Steve just said, it depends on the price that's set.
The reason I mention it is because Well, the reason I mentioned it is because it's hardware, but also it's interesting something Sam said a bit earlier about when you're playing first-person shooters, you have no sense of presence. You walk into a tree, and then you've got to move your mouse to look to see if there's a tree there, whereas you've suddenly got to step further into that the whole idea of presence, and that if you bump into a tree, you'd look to see what you bumped into, which you can do with an Oculus. So I'm wondering if it is a step forward towards that idea that you're in the world.
Again, Biggs has got pretty much the same opinion as me on this. Until Oculus lets me play Better Than Life, I'm not interested. And I said this to you a while back. I said it on one of the MMO buff shows. Until we have the holodeck, count me out, I think. Because otherwise, until then, it's just striving to have that complete immersion experience.
Yeah, but then you can get there by steps, not necessarily leaps and bounds. Like the same way that when like, you know, 2D consoles like the Mega Drive and the SNES came out, at the time, yes, it did seem like big leaps, and then the PlayStation came out, and it's like it is kind of increments, and it's a first stab at moving it forward. So in terms of its ambition and the amount of money that's been sunk into it, and we've already said the pressure that's going to be on them as well, the billions of dollars that have been put into it one way or the other. I'll be interested to see how it goes. And it's at the point now where I want to have a go of one at least. Whereas other VRs, I've kind of gone, that just looks a bit shite. Whereas this is the one that looks like I kind of want to have a play of this in a shop somewhere if I can, see how I feel, and then I might have a go with it.
This is how much I'm not bothered about it. I went to an expo, said the same one I keep talking about in Blackpool, and they had three or four there, and the queues were maybe five people because I was in there early. I still couldn't be asked to wait. I'm like, whatever, until I get one and I can play with it myself, or I can play with the mates or something, you know, I'm probably not going to be asked.
What's the PC interface, Lou?
What do you mean?
It's fucking mental.
How does it connect to your PC?
USB and HDMI. Or right. DVI. So you plug it into one of your graphics card outputs and the USB as well for the input.
Now that's an interesting point. Is the Oculus Rift classed as a console?
No.
No, it's not. It's classed as a peripheral.
Totally a peripheral, 100%.
But it only plays its own games, right? You can't just
Assassin's Creed 2. It's an extension of your monitor, basically.
I could write a game as a developer. I could write a game. In fact, some of the stuff that's in my game is Oculus Rift supported, and I could publish it to PC, and you could play it with an Oculus Rift.
Can you play console games on it, though? Could I play like a PS3 game?
Well,
on the
Oculus Rift? To clear it up, the games have to be adapted for VR, so there has to be. Basically, there's two. Instead of one camera in the game looking into the game, you have two cameras which are slightly offset for each eye. That has to be put into the game, but there's also lots of other things, like the heads-up display won't work in a game.
Mm-hmm.
So in the Half-Life port, rather than you seeing your ammo on the screen, you look to the side of your gun and you've got an ammo counter on the side of your gun, because it just works better that way than having a heads-up display stuck to your viewpoint.
But it's also worth saying as well, again, me and Lou have said this in a few other shows we've been on or whatnot, the problem with VR at the moment is that you can't really move. You can't have any independent movement in it without it affecting you and making you feel disbelief of the world around you. So if you're sat in a cockpit or you're sat on a sofa, then you can play a game. So if you sat down, then you can move your head around and, you know, you're in a fixed position. As soon as you start moving your body independently, it makes you, because you're so immersed in the environment, it makes you want to get up and start moving and do things, because your brain's tricked into thinking you're in the world.
It works best for situations where the simulation also requires you to sit down. So a cockpit in a driving game or a flying game where you'd be sat in a seat and you could look around your cockpit, that's fine. In Half-Life, where you have to move through the world, you've got to do that with a keyboard and mouse or a joypad, and suddenly it almost feels like you're in an electric wheelchair.
Yeah, I imagine
it becomes very weird.
I saw some guy playing a GTA 3. Some GTA game, and he was stood still. He put the Oculus on, and he could look around and stuff and punch people. But it was all first person, so it was really weird anyway, being in GTA game in first person constantly. And then the next thing, he started moving, but he basically had to do that. some detection here. You have to jump up and down on the spot or something to do things. And what's the point?
There are things now where you basically, you're hooked in at the waist and you've got like a Teflon 4 and you wear certain special socks and you can walk on the floor and it detects the motion that you're doing and you can duck and you can move your whole body around.
Are you walking on the spot?
Like a concave disc, isn't it? That you stood in.
Yeah, so you're on a very slippery floor.
Up the side of it.
You're on a very slippery floor, but you're held in by your waist. So you can walk and you get the sensation that you're walking freely around the world and you can swivel and you can do everything in it. So you can move your head and you can duck down and you're holding a device which tracks where your hands are as well. So if you've got a gun, you can hold it up and move it around and do that with it. So that's the closest we've got at the moment to full immersion. And that's pretty much like the, what was the one in Red Dwarf?
Better Than Life.
They had the VR one.
The guns of the radio, whatever it was.
Artificial reality, not virtual reality.
Guys, you're all talking at once again. I know you're getting excited, but come on. Right, so I think the question was from Lou, was do we think it's going to take off this time? I'm going to say no. I'm going to put myself out there and I'm going to say no. I think it's going to fizzle out again at some point. I think VR may be useful for some things like training simulations, medical research, and there's a lot, military things that the parachute training they do with it as well. But not for games. I don't think it's good enough for gamers to accept it fully yet and to be used and to quantify the amount that it's going to cost.
I kind of know where you're coming from in the sense that it's a step towards the full immersion that we all want, but it's not. It's all or nothing without full immersion. It has to be full immersion, or there can't be any halfway steps. Like Sam was talking about with the consoles getting better and better. It was like, okay, you got a Sinclair Spectrum with its big chunky pixels the size of watermelons, and it can only do two colors on the screen and stuff like that. Then you went to the stuff which looked like arcade machines, and you went to the stuff which had 3D in it, and then you went to the stuff which looked almost photoreal, like we are at the moment. And you can consume that in steps, but to go to VR, because it's such an overpowering experience, it has to be perfect, otherwise it's not worth doing.
And it is worth noting that it is, everybody that I've spoken to and has tried one has said that they feel immersed in the world, they feel like they are there, and it takes a little bit to get used to it. I want to experience that, but I can wait.
I reckon that VR's probably sat in the uncanny valley and it's reached the point where it's almost there but not quite, so it's rejected. I hate to say that because I'm buying one and I'm invested in it. I'd love to be able to do this and to get into it, but I am probably of a similar opinion to you in that respect that I don't think we're quite there yet, in the same way that 3D movies just isn't quite there yet, and it probably never will be until the change of technology completely, because it just doesn't work. And it's so close to working, but it not quite, that it just doesn't work.
My opinion is, well, my heart says yes, but my head says no. Yeah. I want it to work. I want it to be good. I want to be immersed in games, but I can't see it working. And the more important thing is, in order for this hardware to take off and work, it needs support of the software companies. It needs a big place behind it, and that ain't going to happen.
I don't think so, because people are, again, software companies are all very much of the ilk of big developers. They're chasing the money, they're chasing the market, and they need the income. Yeah, and they don't risk things. It lies in the hands of the indie developers, basically, and it does. But unfortunately, indie developers that make it and want to and start making money and then become it becomes their full-time job and they can make a living off it, then it becomes a risk for them as well. So they're going to stop possibly supporting it. It seems to be fun projects. All of the VR games, indie VR games that I've seen, only a couple of hours long, you know? I mean, I know there's a few exceptions to that, but... Sam, what do you reckon?
Until it starts making money.
What you just said is actually quite interesting, that they're only 2 hours long, and I wonder how long you can actually stay in that world before you start to really get into the uncanny valley problems.
Hey, that's an interesting thing. I never thought of that.
I'm sure we've all talked about these long gaming sessions that we've had, where we've put hours and hours and hours in, You know, you'll get up and have a drink and go to the toilet every now and then, but you're basically in it. You're basically in it.
Hardcore.
No, I don't call myself toilets. Hardcore, actually. So.
Who needs a toilet?
So, if you've done like 6 hours of, I don't know, whatever VR game it is, and you're going to start to feel weird and displaced, and then when you take it off again, you've just been in this thing for 6 hours, and then you're in the real, physical, tangible world. There's going to be an adjustment period, and a bit like Steve said, I kind of want it to work, but there's part of my brain is saying there's going to be a weird, disconnected feeling that's going to put you off it after a while. It's going to make you feel weird and possibly a bit ill.
So much science fiction, cyberpunk specifically, is focused on that as well as a problem. And again, I think it's one of those, I never really thought about it in any detail, but I think if it did take off, I think there's social issues there immediately. Mm. Especially because gaming's becoming more and more and more popular.
Even without the social issues, the actual guidelines, which I've read through from cover to cover, do talk about this. And what they say is that most people can't handle more than about an hour in a VR sim. It just becomes uncomfortable, and the cumulative effect of all of the disconnect between what your eyes are seeing and what's happening on screen and what your body's feeling, that disconnect just leads to people feeling sick. It's still a massive problem because
Oculus
we're just not
Rift
ready for it.
Edition.
Yeah, they call it simulator sickness, and it's the same with everyone, and it doesn't matter what they're doing. They've made it as good as they can, but there's still fundamental problems with the way that games work.
Basically, until humankind can induce controllable dreams on people, I don't think this is going to happen. Or we have a holodeck, which we know is almost impossible. Well, I would say impossible. It's science
fiction. I don't
like holodecks.
I don't think it's
impossible with science.
No, that's the thing. It's impossible now, but tomorrow it may not be. That's the beauty of science, so isn't it?
Yeah. I always feel like in your holodeck, you're going to run into a wall.
Well, the holodeck accounts for that, though, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does account for
does
that.
It?
Yeah,
they in the holodeck, they have, like, you know, they'll go to San Francisco. They went to one of them, and it's like, yeah, it's fine. You just it must have a weird floor thing where you can keep walking and it doesn't ever let you hit the wall.
I know there'll be a description for it out there if anyone wants to look it
the,
up.
The most feasible solution is still, I think, like total immersion.
Yeah.
Because then you're taking out, just better than life. Because then you're taking out the problems with movement. If you can just kind of trigger or fire the synapses in the brain that give you feedback for that, which is something that is doable today, maybe not the level we're talking about, but you can make people feel false feelings in their legs and their arms by triggering the neurons in the brain. I think that's the most direct route and that's the most total immersion, but that with itself...
And it scares the crap out of me, that.
It brings its own problems.
Like
people not wanting to leave this false reality.
Well, not only that, but the path to that, just the you know, you can imagine all of the path towards getting to realism within that would be really uncomfortable and really, it'd send people mad.
You imagine, I mean, someone like me who doesn't work like every day of the year because I'm a contractor, imagine me coming out of a contract, spending a few days in a simulator and then kind of getting immersed in it and getting to the point where, right, I'm going to have to start eating soon. Or, you know, you're drinking occasionally or whatever. You've got yourself set up. But and then, you know, you get to a point where your electricity gets cut off and you've been in this state for so long. Again, science fiction has explored these avenues in many different ways. It's really interesting to think about, but it's also petrifying in my eyes.
At least you still look the same, Chris.
Yeah.
I mean, there's another issue as well. Like, if you were to play something like a Better Than Life type game, and let's say Better Than Life isn't the example, because for a game, you kind of want adversity, and Better Than Life is just a fantasy. So let's even say it's a game. There's still lots of wish fulfillment in computer games. So you go into a computer game where everything runs on a reasonably fair system of logic that is dependable. Like, you know that if you open up a box, you're going to find something inside. Do you know what I mean? That kind of stuff. Mm. And then you go out into the real world where it just isn't like that. Mm. It isn't fair. Like, there's logic and rules in the real world, but you can expect them to be there for you like you can in a computer game.
It could lead to mass depression.
Yeah,
you
know, yeah.
Yeah, totally.
Not being able to accept reality. There's all these psychological ramifications that, I don't know. It is a little bit frightening.
I don't think we're prepared for that stuff.
We're definitely
not ready.
Leaving the scary world of VR.
Yeah.
What's everyone's thoughts on haptic technology?
Yeah, I've mentioned that a few times in relation.
Can you describe what you mean by haptic?
Feedback.
In what way?
There's different methods. A vibrating joypad being a simple one of them. You get tactile haptic feedback, which I think the Steam controller was supposed to have, where it changes its surface or something to suit the terrain you're on. There's one I read about today by a robotics company that actually it's got a series of actuators built into a glove. And what it does is that actually stops your movement. So if you were in VR to pick up a cup, it would stop your hand from closing any further, as if you were contacting a cup.
And then there's haptic feedback suits where you'd get bullet hits as you get shot.
You really don't want that glove to crash, do you?
No. Depends what you're doing at the time.
Yeah, it depends what kind of game you happen to be playing.
Yes.
And it has to crash.
I was going to say,
serious bodily injuries to a very...
If you go to the hospital, I fell on it.
Again, I don't think we need haptic feedback stuff unless it's for a specific application. I think, as pretty much all of us have said, I think it's a total immersion or not at all. Simulating all the different immersion, all the different senses is still not real, and we're going to know that in our brains.
I think it does add an element, though. If you try playing a game with force feedback and then without force feedback, it does make a difference.
Well, it makes a difference to the games. Again, I'm going to bring it up. Metal Gear Solid games, they are all full of moments where you have to put the controller on your arm, like we experienced the other night, and to heal your arm after the one button bashing.
One really quick. What they are really good at, and this is something that with our playthrough we've never even touched upon, and I forgot about this thing. You just brought it up. And you're not playing with vibrate, but there's loads of points in Metal Gear where they use the vibrate function of the controller to genius levels. Like when Meryl gets shot in that bit we did in the other episode, Snake leans down and touches her neck, and the controller vibrates a pulse. There's loads of stuff like that in Metal Gear where they use the vibrate in really clever ways to do that. And that kind of stuff I actually really do like. So haptic feedback. I'm actually into the idea of it.
I like it on the. I like feedback on the controller, and I was never a skeptic of that. I always, since the N64, I was a fan of it. But there's also the other like simple uses of it, where you're walking around and it makes a bit of a rumble when you're walking near something, and that happens in games quite a lot these days. But that's again, Kojima's use of it is very different.
I've never liked rumble in games. But that's I've experienced the typical rumble thing, which is where something explodes or something fires and the pad just vibrates, or a boss comes out of a doorway, it's got in your hand. It's like, just why are you even doing this?
That's like, bad use of it, then, isn't it?
Yeah, it is bad use of it, and most of it is bad use of it. I've never played a game like you've just mentioned there, Metal Gear Solid, that makes good use of it.
Gran Turismo.
I've not played it.
Oh. Yeah, that's.
When you're driving over the rumble strips and everything, that it gives you a little bit of a on the side of the joypad that's actually going over.
That's cool.
And it's also good for feedback when you've been hit. Mm. Again, when you've been hit in a game, it can be used in good and bad ways. But I think in terms of getting that working with VR, which I've often talked about haptic feedback and VR at the same time, I still don't think it's right. Still don't think it's enough.
Well, if you've got a full haptic feedback suit, what level do you want to take it to? Because the reason that pain exists in living beings is to keep us alive. It's a self-preservation thing. So do you actually want genuine pain when you're playing a computer game to actually make you better at the game?
No.
Or do you want just a sensation that says you've been hurt, but then is it really... It's weird. Where do you draw the line with that sort of stuff?
It's called haptic feedback. It's not haptic death, is it?
No, I know, but I'm saying we're talking about projecting into the future with the where this stuff could go. If you've got a full haptic feedback suit and you get shot in the left shoulder, how much of that sensation do you really want?
Well, it would have to be limited for health and safety reasons.
Yeah, health and safety wouldn't allow anything more than a tick to happen.
The interesting thing is that with VR, even without the haptic feedback, it changes the way that you acting games. Like, if you play a really intense military combat simulator and everyone's firing at you and there's bullets whizzing over your head and explosions going on, your first instinct is to shit yourself and hide behind a barrier, not to run in screaming and shooting like you'd normally do. So even just the presence of vision and sound is enough to really change the way you react to it. So if you're getting shot, I think that would probably push a lot of people over the edge. I know we're talking exactly the same way that when they invented the first powered vehicles, it was like 10 miles per hour, your face will fall off.
You'll suffocate if you go faster than walking speed.
And it does feel like we're in that situation where, you know, 50 years down the line, or 20 years down the line, people are going to be laughing at us now, like how old-fashioned we were, saying the human brain can't handle such things.
For clarity, future people, if you think that I'm a naysayer, fine, but I like technology. I like seeing it advance. I'm not saying it will never work. I just think in its current form and that what they're aiming for as it is now, I know that they haven't really said this is the end point, but what they're aiming for, a virtual reality headset, I don't think is enough right now. In the future, we'll have much more immersion in some way, shape or form.
It's kind of somewhat loosely linked. Lou mentioned there about the sound and the vision is enough to immerse you. That's two of your five senses.
Yep.
There's
more than five senses.
More than five.
Sorry. Way more than five senses.
No, that's two of, well,
yeah, there's way
the
more
five
than
standard
five
senses.
Yeah.
Yeah. You might have 12 senses, but the majority of people focus on five. But
there's telekinesis and everything.
There's new technology coming out that actually gives olfactory feedback.
Right, so you smell it.
Yeah. So it can produce smells, and it's not something where, you know, it's been touted in the past where it just releases a series of gases. It's actually quite a complex like linkage of chemicals that produces something not exactly like the smell, but something close enough for if you're immersed in it, you identify that as the smell, so your brain kind of fills in the gaps.
How many games do you end up going to a sewer at some point? That could be fucking old.
Again, I'm well, not.
I've just been playing Far Cry 3 and I've been doing the bit where you got to burn down the drugs field and I thought,
Well, no, again, that's, you know, again, it's an extra level of immersion, and I don't think I'd be that arsed about it because I don't want to smell what's going on in the game, and if it's a bad smell, it doesn't immerse me anymore. It just makes me want to turn the smell off.
I love that idea, I've got to say. I know I was actually thinking about this today. There are certain smells that remind me of games, and I'm not entirely sure why. There are certain smells of deodorant, for instance. Certain brands of deodorant that remind me of games from my youth. Like, there's a certain, I think it's Lynx Africa, reminds me of Duke Nukem. I don't know why.
You played it.
Maybe, but it's like, you know how smell is a direct connection to memory? It instantly makes me think of these games and playing these games. The smells that remind me of Final Fantasy VII probably is because I was wearing these at the time, but the idea that a game would give you a smell and give you smells that reinforce memories, I think would make games much more memorable. They make those scenes, those moments that we talk about
100%
way better.
But I'm saying that I mean my wife, she gets really, really like moody when she smells something that she doesn't like, and whatever it is. And as, believe me, a lot of smells turn her off. You know, it's not very nice at all. And
who wear the beard?
No, you know, I didn't mean anything sexual at all. Yeah. Then I was just talking about smells in general. She hates the smell of curry, for example, but she doesn't mind eating it. It's weird, but I'm not as bothered about that. But I still don't really want to smell, as Sam said, a sewer in a game. I don't really want to smell the mounds of dead bodies in front of me, and I'm not into that.
But it would be a controlled experience.
That far.
Steve.
I don't think it would go to replicate every smell in the game, but for example, if you were walking through an orchard, you might get a subtle whiff of apple or something, you know, just little subtleties. Not you can smell every single thing in the room combined, because that would be too much.
But again, it's controlled by the developer, and
yeah.
There's no guarantee that I could play a game that, you know, we'd have to have smell ratings on games, wouldn't we? You know, like the ESRB.
You'd have a volume control, wouldn't you? You'd have a smell volume control, so you could turn it down and just have very subtle smells, or you could crank it right up and have the full sewer experience.
Yeah.
I like the idea. I really like the idea. I'm intrigued by the chemistry. I think that'd be hard to do, but I think it'd be very cool if you could do that, and I would be well up for that, because I think, like I say, smells already remind me of games. So if games actually generated those smells.
There's a link I've just posted in the chat that's directly related to olfactory feedback and gaming.
Hmm. Short paper. I'll read that later on. But yeah, I'm all for that.
Another interesting concept, I guess, but I don't know. Well, the smell, I don't know how I feel about that. Yeah, because there's a lot of stuff in games that you do that's really quite unpleasant and violent, and I don't want to necessarily smell that when I'm running around with the flamethrower killing people. Mm. I don't think I want to smell that.
You know what
I
mean? There's bacon.
Maybe like a subtle smell of petrol or something.
It could be used as
maybe. I don't know.
As a deterrent for people who get violent when they play video games.
Imagine the smell of it. Yeah. Don't go around killing people because it smells bad. Yeah. You do.
Don't burn your family to death.
Get recognised the smell of a black eye.
I think we're being very literal about this, and we're assuming that developers would be very literal about it too, but I think it would be artistically controlled, just the same way that the visuals and the sounds are, and the way that sound in movies, for instance, when there's a battle going on, you don't hear the entire battle, you hear the bits that are happening like on screen. Hmm. And yeah. I think the same would be true of the smells. The smells would be very specialised smells related to things that were happening in the game. Not necessarily you would smell some burning corpses or the sewers or anything like that.
But at the same time, if they willfully neglected to give you those things when you really think they should be the overwhelming scent, then you've got to notice it and it's got to break your immersion. If you are, for example, in an orchard that you've just killed a lot of people in and burned them, and it smells like apples, you're going to be like, it shouldn't really smell like apples right now, should it? Do you know what I mean?
It might smell like burnt apples.
Burnt apples, yeah, like apple pie or something. it's another interesting thought. I don't know. Yeah. Not sure how I feel about that.
Smell-o-vision failed, didn't it? Scratch and sniff failed.
Yeah, but that's because you were limited by what was on the card.
I know.
This can produce.
It's very different. Yeah. I just think maybe they're trying a bit too hard with these, with VR and with. It's cool that they're looking at it, but the games are okay as they are. And since games came out, we've had.
Oh, yeah,
no, listen.
But Sonic the Hedgehog was okay.
No, I'm not saying that the game shouldn't advance. In terms of the way that we control games as human beings, I think has been the same pretty much since the start, and it hasn't really changed. We've got all these different control types, but we've been controlling them with our hands, and that's it.
It's refined,
but that's how we control the world around us.
Yeah,
with our hands.
So why do we need to immerse ourselves in games in more depth?
It's the progression of technology, just because we can.
Again, I'm happy to experience it and see it happen. The other way around. I mean, see it happen first and experience it, but and be part of it possibly. But I'm not. I wouldn't chase it as a technology. You know, I'm
glad that some people are though, because I think we'll never get to the full immersion that you want without these baby steps.
Of course not. No. But I said there's even problems with that immersion, and I'm not sure. Matrix.
Yeah,
I'd love to live in the Matrix. I'd spawn with sunglasses and a leather coat, and my hair would be cool, and it'd all be green.
Yeah, but you'd try to rocket jump over everyone.
Yeah, I'd fly.
You'd break it somehow, though.
Yeah,
you'd fucking wall hack it.
The first thing I'd do in the Matrix is try and double jump off a bin.
Yeah. Anyway, moving on. Have we got any other topics or hardware specific that we want to talk about?
Well, I would just, Jen, what does everybody think about motion control in general? Because we've sort of talked about a lot of stuff. And motion control is one of those future of gaming type things that gets bandied on about. Is anybody that into it? Has anybody ever been that into it?
You know what is one of the most useless things I've ever experienced?
Accelerometer.
Six-axis bollocks.
Yeah.
Oh, what? I've never found it useful in any game yet.
No. It's a gimmick.
It's pointless.
But it works. It works for the Wiimote. It's the same thing.
The Wiimote's a different controller, though, isn't it? It's a different method of doing it.
But it's still six axis. It's still accelerometers.
Okay.
And tilt right. sensors.
So it's not this control pad that I'm talking about. It's not the six axis on the PS3 right. and PS4.
So what you're criticizing is the fact that that has six axis when it's a traditional joystick.
It does. No, no. I'm criticizing that these actions, when I'm playing a game, don't help. They don't. I'm sat back in a lazy boy, right? I'm playing like this, and I've probably got the controller up at an angle like that. When I need to have it down flat, it's a ball ache. You know what? I had the same problem when I was playing Skyward Sword with on the Wiimote.
Yeah, you've got to put that. Down...
Go on.
I was going to say, you've got to put that face down every time you start it up, haven't you?
Yeah, and if you miss it, it's like, oh, God, I've restarted all again.
So you've got to calibrate it?
Yeah, every time. But either way, it's still... I got to a point where I was calibrating it at an angle so it made more sense for when I was laid down, when I was sat down. But again, the Wii is supposed to be played stood up, isn't it? It's the idea of it. But
it's just bollocks.
For all, well, you don't do that for all games. But I know, I like the Wii. I said, I thought the control system was okay. I mean, these buttons here at the bottom.
Yeah,
in the worst place you could ever have. I mean, it's good for this.
It's like shift your hand down around, to get to them, and then shift it back up to do the other ones.
The reason that I like that is so you can play it like a console pad. But I've never actually played a game like that ever. But yeah, when you're playing it, especially because your fingers on the trigger there, it's really awkward to touch either of those two, and you do need to do it in a lot of games.
So what do you think of them, Sam?
I kind of not that bothered for them. I think the way, again, it's a case of like the way they are now is kind of an awkward, not very satisfying point. Like, I played Twilight Princess, and I thought that the motion controls for that were okay, but I could have happily done without them and just played on a normal controller. Like, I don't think they really added that much to the experience, in my opinion, that a normal controller could not have done, and actually done it easier. And that's my experience of most the Kinect could just do one. Like, it's everything I've done with the Kinect has been just rubbish.
Really impressed with it though when I play the Kinect. I've actually got another use for it at the moment, which is development based, which is not gaming. Well, it is gaming related for me, but not in terms of playing games. But I really thought it was really cool, but it's impractical to use. That's the only problem with it. There's no room in England. You don't have a big enough front room.
The Kinect is an awesome piece of hardware, but its application to games is extremely limited to what the hardware is capable of. Where you can 3D map with a Kinect, it's got two cameras, so it's got stereo vision.
That's what.
So you can actually scan things with it.
That's what I'm doing with it. I'm going to be. Using it to do motion capture for animations for our game, because I downloaded something from the Unity Asset Store a few weeks ago, and it's called Game Capture or something, I can't remember, but it's just a plug into Unity, and I can plug my my Kinect into my PC, and it'll just pick me up. I know I'm going to have to do a lot of cleanup of the data because it's not going to be 100% awesome. It's not proper. Like,
you have to do a lot of cleanup of your front room as well when you're wall running across it.
Yeah. I have thought about that. I'm like, one, it's me doing it. I'm not exactly the most nimble of people on the planet. Two, can't parkour, by the way. I'm competing directly with Ubisoft here, who've got a bloody Assassin's Creed Assault Course and all the best parkour runners on the planet running it at the moment.
Yeah, but you've got your front room and loads of ping pong balls and you can stick over yourself.
just for effect, I don't actually need the ping pong balls for the Kinect. I'm just putting it on anyway just so I can feel like...
Makes you get in the mood.
I've just seen BBC headline of Blackpool man falls off roof attempted to parkour.
While wearing Blackpool VR man headset. loses face scratching it against brick wall after parkour fail. It's a bit long for a headline, that. But yeah. No, I mean, I'm with Steve though. It is a brilliant, impressive piece of hardware. I was really impressed with how accurate it was and the fact that it did. You know, not just that, the voice recognition as well was pretty cool on it. It doesn't work for everybody. I don't know why it works for me and not everybody else, but I quite liked it. But yeah, the fact that it picked up everything, and it picked up two people on the screen at the same time as well.
Kind of like detect your heartbeat and stuff as well. I saw something with the Xbox One that it could check your your heat signature and your heartbeat and stuff like that, and
it's
respiration.
It's a comparison
rate.
Between the pigment of your skin. So right. It estimates the increased blood flow with the pigment change. Right. You get mobile phone apps that do the same if you hold your finger next to the light in the camera.
That's quite interesting.
And estimate your pulse rate.
Mm. Cool.
Yeah, I do keep meaning to get Kinect Sports or some. Have I got Kinect Sports? There's one I wanted to get that sounded quite interesting for actually getting fit, but haven't yet.
Kinect Kwando.
Hello, Slim Shady 10/24/14. Yes, this stream is about this stream is about the government, according to What Potato Power. No, this stream is about games. We're Resonance Arcade, and we have a couple of hours every Wednesday. And we talk about a subject. Today we're talking about gaming hardware. So we've been talking about consoles, controllers, PCs, upgrading them. We've just been talking about VR, for example. So yeah, we're overrunning a bit tonight. But I think we should probably start doing the show a little bit later, as we were talking about last week. Because no one seems to come on for the first hour. And then we start getting people coming on later on in the day. But we'll see. We'll talk about that in a bit detail after the show.
One thing that I kind of want to shot in towards the end, which is something that it upsets me a little bit, but it's a downfall of arcades.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm with you there a little bit.
Because there was nothing more exciting as a child than going and sitting in a big rig.
Or petrifying. My local arcades, they were like drug dens, I swear, whorehouses. They were did you go to the one in Stockton that was on the back of... I can't remember the name of the road. It's totally been demolished now. But there was an arcade in like this really rickety old shed that was.
Was that part of the indoor market?
No. The indoor market came well after that, I think. Anyway,
I used to go to Red Car.
I did as well. Actually, I played quite a lot there, and Whitby as well. That had a few good arcade places. But yeah, don't get them now, do you?
You get the same three shit games. You get the broken gun game where you can't aim properly on it. You get the broken racing game where one of the steering wheels, invariably the one you're in, is broken.
Yep.
Or you get fruit machines of endless varieties. Or the dance game, maybe.
That's just awful. I hate fruit machines.
Yeah.
They don't even give you any fruit.
No.
Ah, rubbish.
But I used to love arcades. I used to love going to arcades and finding games that, you know, just new games that I'd not played before. And Choplifter. I used to play Choplifter all the time. Never worked out what to do with it, but I used to go for that machine whenever I could. But yeah, arcades are just not what they were.
Didn't you once spend an entire holiday playing Two Crude Dudes?
Yeah, me and Anthony played Crude Buster to completion. We completed an arcade game.
Two Crude Dudes, is that like a final fight with smaller characters?
You pick people up and throw them in cars and
dogs bite your nipples.
That sounds like the game that I've been trying to think of forever. And was one of them. Did one of them have a yellow jumper on?
Yep.
And was he bald? Possibly. Or one of them. One of them.
Both had mohawks.
It was like a fighting game. You used to run around, pick up bottles and glasses, and it was like a final fight, but there were much smaller characters. Two Crude Dudes. I'm writing this motherfucker down.
Yeah, Crude Buster, I think it was
called. Crude Buster was the Japanese version Data East game. It might not be that. There's also there's other games which have got like a 3D perspective, and there's one, a really good one called Growl.
That doesn't ring bell, but Two Crude does, so I'm thinking that, and considering you guys went to the same arcades as me, it might even be the one, because the one I'm thinking of was in Redcar.
This one was in Wales.
All right. Well, the one I'm thinking of was in Redcar or Whitby, so maybe it isn't the same one. But I'm going to look at that up afterwards, and I've been looking for it for years. If it is,
arcades used to do the games before they came out on your console, so you get like Tekken would be out in the arcade before it would come out on the PlayStation. Tekken 2, all that kind of stuff was pretty cool.
Yeah.
And it was kind of like, it was games that you, like we said with the light gun before, it was the kind of game and experience you couldn't get at home. There was a reason to go there, because they actually did up their game when consoles got popular. For a while, they did up their game and made these, like, you know, the big Daytona thing where you sit in the full seat and all that. Like, that was cool, but it...
I reckon they'll come back, you know. I reckon arcades will come back. Because games, as I said before, if they're getting more popular, I'm thinking, mind you, it's getting...
Social.
It's a convenient thing, though, again, isn't it? Thinking about it, we have convenience of having all of this awesome technology in our houses, and we don't have to leave.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things about the arcades is the arcade machines were invariably better than anything you had at home. They were running really smooth and looked better than any console you could buy. It was like you had to go to the arcade to get that experience, whereas now you can get the experience in your home easy. You can't make an arcade machine that's better than the computer that you're sat in front of.
But apart from the ones where you've got the big rigs, which kind of adds to the immersion. Do you remember Afterburner? Was it Afterburner where you're in kind of like the gyroscope and you...
Afterburner had partial movement. There was also G-Lock, which had
full... G-Lock, that was it.
Motion, yeah, that was crazy.
So many people lost their change on that game. It was awesome.
It had a...
Just hang on the queue and pick up on...
It had like mandatory seatbelt in and everything. That was brilliant. G-Lock 360.
Maybe that's where VR belongs in arcades. Maybe it'll be too expensive.
I was thinking that, and if they also could update the arcades so that it became like an online thing, so that you could actually go down and go like, right, I'll go down to my arcade in my town, you go down to your arcade in your town, but then you've got to get on the machine at the right time, haven't you, so it wouldn't really work.
No.
Well, if you can play against your mates, like, that would be great.
I'll tell you what, this is actually, and I've seen this already done, but this is an interesting application of VR. Rather than playing 3D games, you put your VR thing on and walk through a 3D arcade and play the arcade machine.
That again, that's what I said. I talked about that Alone, I think it was, that game, that horror game where you sat on a couch with a VR headset on. You're playing a game, but the room around you is making funny sounds and noises. Mm. That really worked. That looked amazing. It looked like something I wanted to try. But that's a good idea. Mm. Even if you just jump between the arcade machines, I don't know.
Yeah, virtual arcade, so you've actually got all the surrounding... There's actually... You can download tracks, which are called arcade ambience, which you can download different years.
I'm going to write this down. This is a great idea.
you can have the sound of people playing arcade games and the sound that those arcade games made as a soundtrack, which is like an hour-long soundtrack, which would loop.
If you start to allow people to use VR socially, all they're going to do is try to have cyber sex with each other.
Well, of course they are. Yeah, I mean that will be an initial application, won't it? You'll have like a fleshlight with a network cable in the back.
Fleshlight plugged into a car battery.
Yeah. I think I'll stick with the 9-volt. I'm not sure I want to go for the full 12 yet, Steve.
Right. So, any other hardware
that anyone wants
a honourable mention?
I can't think of anything else.
Any hardware that you guys have, that you can think has been irredeemably terrible?
Well, I haven't played it, but I've heard about really bad ones. That the Jaguar was supposed to be irredeemably terrible, wasn't it?
Jaguar was excellent. It was badly supported. It was Atari who couldn't do anything right.
It was really expensive as well.
Was just the one that was it the 3DO then? I'm sure there was one console that had that flying game with the woman going, "Where did you learn to fly?" on it that I've seen footage of. It's like a 3D game, but it's really terrible. And it was
the Neo Geo, I think. The Jaguar both came out roughly the same time, and neither of them took off because they were way too expensive. They were better than anything else that was out then, but they were way too expensive to
definitely
to buy.
Wasn't the Neo Geo that. If it's a 3D one, it might be like the CDI or the something like that.
CDI sounds familiar, yeah.
Philips CDI, yeah.
CDI.
3DO, yeah. Those CD two 32. Didn't do well. Yeah. But the Jaguar was a great console, but just had the half-wits at Atari doing the marketing for it. And the Neo Geo was a great console because it was basically an arcade machine, but it was ridiculously expensive.
Hmm. Wasn't the Jaguar, it was touted as the first 64-bit console, but it wasn't actually 64-bit, was it?
It had two 32-bit processors in it, and they said 32 and 32 make 64.
That's how it works.
What good games were on the Jaguar then?
Aliens vs. Predator. Yeah, that was a definitive version. It had Doom on it as well, and it had some good fighting games on it.
Tempest 2000 first came out on the...
Oh, God!
Didn't it?
Yes, it did. Jeff Minter.
I unfortunately haven't played either consoles for many years. I played some like in a shop or something, but I keep meaning to buy both of them, but I just haven't got around to it yet.
We've got a Jaguar, haven't we?
Yeah, me and Lou actually have a collaborative collection. Collaborative collection.
Yeah.
We actually have a Jaguar, a mint boxed.
Nice.
Yeah, got a mint box Commodore 64 as well.
Mint box pretty much everything.
Mm.
Not a minor minting box.
So a NES, an original box NES, not a promotional box, but the original first release
why
in a box.
Why have you got a collection together? Why not just?
Because we both bought separate ones. We tried to buy a Neo Geo, but it got up to 150 quid on eBay, and I thought, right, I'm not going to try anymore. Yeah.
Plus,
especially the games were like 100 quid each as well.
We both already had an existing kind of mini collection of consoles together, so we thought, right, well, let's just pump them together and make like a mega collection.
Fair enough.
And half of it lives at my house and half of it lives at Lou's.
Half is right above my head.
Half is right behind me.
So there.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. More talk about my console collection.
Just your console pads collection then.
Yeah, that's all I've got, pads.
Basket full of controllers.
Yeah.
I love the fact that you got a Koenig Speedking though. I didn't know you had that.
Fuck me, man.
With that?
It's the worst thing ever. Okay, no one heard me earlier if they were listening.
Do it again.
It's the worst joystick ever.
It's got the best sound though.
Best sound, worst joystick, but it just kills you. Your arm is in agony after you've done it. It's even if you're doing that, but you're doing it for an hour or so, there's something about the ergonomics of this particular joystick that just hurts. It just hurts to play it, and you end up squeezing it really tight as well with your arm while you're playing.
I think I might be able to trump that.
Go on. What the fuck is that? Oh, right, yes.
How did I forget about that? That's a Dreamcast, isn't it?
I saw one of them at a convention once.
This is awful.
Yeah,
it does not work at all. You can't fish with it.
You tried to catch real fish with it,
Steve. That's the lake.
And on the back. And
shit, cast this, hasn't it?
Lou's childhood favourite.
Oh,
I had one of them.
Yeah, is that mine?
It's part of the collection.
All right. So
quick shot. That was the other joysticks that I was talking about earlier, the ones that are identical but different.
Yeah, that was my Mega Drive pad. I love that. It's busy being controller.
Identical but different. Sorry, identical but different logos. Yeah, anyway, unless anyone else has any other things, I think we should probably wrap up.
I think I'm done, yeah. I was going to talk about monitors, but I think it's...
I think we could easily have another show on hardware, and we might even continue with it next week, possibly. We'll see how we feel. Because we can talk about this kind of stuff forever. It's not as interesting, I don't think, as the games themselves, but I think it's still relevant.
Yeah.
Anyway, so yes, that wraps it up for this week, everybody. Thank you for watching. Sorry for the technical problems.
We have Sam this week.
Yes, we do have Sam's face, and his audio was pretty good through the entire show. So, yeah, hopefully he'll live at his mum's from now on.
Yeah, you can't go leave from there.
You're not allowed to go anywhere, yeah. Catch us on Friday. We'll be streaming a pre-record of Far Cry 3. I'll be streaming it, and I don't know if I'll do any announcing or not, but I'll be playing it at 6:30 as normal. In fact, I'll play it a bit later. I'll do it about maybe 8 o'clock. But we're gonna re-announce some times. We're gonna change it up, I think, possibly if everyone's up for it. If not, then we'll just keep doing 6:30. Doesn't bother me either way. But it seems to be that people start coming on at least towards 7:30.
Yeah.
So it would make sense to postpone it for another hour, I think. Apart from that, we've got next Monday, we've got, hopefully, fingers crossed, the last part of Metal Gear Solid 1 coming up. It's got to be, hasn't it? We're about an hour away from the end, I think, now. We're fighting Metal Gear and Liquid. We've just put all the PAL keys in. Or we're just about to put the third one in, I think.
Yeah, just about to put the last one in.
And then next Wednesday, we'll be back with Resonance Arcade again. Excuse me. Thank you very much for watching, everybody, and we will catch you next week.
Cheers.
See you later.
Bye.